Hey, it's Whitney from ecovegangal.com and welcome back to the live weekly Q&A that happens every Saturday right here on Google Plus and YouTube. I am going to give a few quick instructions for any of you who might be new, and thank you so much for joining if you are. First of all, to those who are watching the recording, the most important thing for you to know is that you can skip forward to any section of this video by looking in the description field and will allow you to just jump right to whatever question you want. You don't have to watch the entire thing if you don't have time or don't want to. However, I often hear that people enjoy watching them or listening to them while they're doing all sorts of things. Last week, someone told me that he listened while doing a great workout. I know people that listen in the car or while they're cleaning and cooking, and all that's so great to hear. So I know it's not the ideal YouTube length, but I'm still putting it up here so that you have the visuals that go along with the audio here. And for those of you watching live, it's a really neat way to interact with me and my guest today, Jason Robel, who I'll introduce in a moment. You can ask your questions live, and the way you do that is through Google Plus. You do not ask your questions on YouTube. What you do is go to the Google Plus event page, and there's three ways to find that. One, easiest way is on the Facebook page, the Eco Vegan Gal Facebook page, or on Twitter, or you can look up Eco Vegan Gal on Google Plus, find that account, click on the event, and open up the window where you'll watch these videos, and there's a Q&A app on usually the right-hand side. You can do this on the computer or a mobile device. And that is the primary way that we're going to take questions today. If we have time, we can look on the event page, but I really encourage you to ask on the Q&A app instead of the event page. There's also a cool feature called Applause that people can now use on Google Plus, and I have never used it myself, but apparently you can like cheer on people. I don't know. It's automatically on now. So if you see that there, play around with it. I'm really curious how it works, and I think it's kind of neat. So today we have a lot of questions. We have actually about 11 questions that were submitted in advance, and we will save time for the live questions. We try to keep these as close to an hour as possible, but chances are this is going to go maybe closer to an hour and a half. Just going to be honest with you. And of course, if you see the recording, you already know that. And you can always, you know, come back and watch the recording anytime. And I believe that YouTube notes when you stop watching a video, but I'm not entirely sure. I forget about that. Let me know if you remember, because I believe if you go away from a long video and you come back, it'll remember where your place was, which is pretty cool. So with no further ado, let's jump right in to today's questions. But of course, if you don't know who Jason is yet, why don't you give yourself a quick introduction? This is your third time on the Q&A?
Yes, it is. It is my third time. I feel like it's being on the cover of the Rolling Stone, like I'm the current record holder for being the most
SNL.
Invited back guest.
No, I think SNL would be.
Yeah, there. SNL. It's yeah. Like I've been guest hosting here with you. It's my third time. And this is cool because it's a pre-holiday edition. Thanksgiving is coming up. So maybe there'll be some really cool holiday questions. Whitney and I both have a lot of experience. But for those of you who are brand new, my name is Jason Robel. I'm a vegan chef and health edutainer. I also have a YouTube channel called The J. Roe Show, which you can find at Jason Robel TV. Also, you can check out the reruns of the first season of my TV show, How to Lift 100 on the Cooking Channel, Mondays at 8, or you can watch it live online at ulive, that's the letter ulive.com. I'm working on my first book for Hay House right now, which will be done next year and out in 2016. So I'm happy to be here to answer your questions about vegan cooking, lifestyle, nutrition, ethics, fashion, tattoos, pretty much anything under the sun.
Yep.
Been doing this for 17 years, so.
And definitely check out the past Q&As. They are two of my most popular Q&As because they're really in-depth, especially the first one.
Yeah.
Because we went really far in-depth about nutrition and vitamins and minerals on a vegan diet, thriving on a vegan diet, vegan men's health. He talked about his tattoos in the past. So if you enjoy what you see today, definitely check those out. I'll link to those down below in the description field. And everything that we talk about will be linked. I want to just let you know, though, that the links usually take 24 to 48 hours to go up. I have my amazing helper, Rachel, who compiles all of that. So send some love to Rachel for all of her great help with making that happen. And usually those are done and, you know, Sunday night, and I try to get them up by Monday. So be patient with those, and those will be there for you to link to everything that we mentioned, whether it's websites or videos or books and all of that products that we mentioned right down below. So let's jump right into the questions because we have a lot. So the first one comes from Lisa. And Lisa said, I'm a night shift healthcare worker who is looking for an energy boost to keep me going at night. I've been thinking about giving maca root powder a try. Any suggestions for a first timer, such as how much to start out using, best type to blend to use in it, etc.? So why don't we start with just maca and then we can answer about other options for energy.
Certainly. So maca root is something that's been used for centuries in a lot of South American, Mesoamerican cultures. The Aztecs and the Incans would use maca back in the day to actually give to their athletes and their warriors to give them a major hormonal boost, especially in the testosterone department. So they would go off into battle or go off to their games and have a lot more sustained energy levels of hormones. In terms of what is available now, there's basically two forms of maca. There's raw maca, and then there's roasted or gelatinized. What I find is interesting is my body reacts very differently to the raw and then the gelatinized. I find that personally, if you go back and you research how those Mesoamerican cultures took the maca, they never ate it raw. It was always roasted. It was always cooked down in some way. And what you find is that through the cooking process, like with any food, is it's changing it on a structural level. The compounds and the nutrients are changing. So the research I've seen is that some people react much more favorably to the roasted or the gelatinized versions. Myself included, if I take a raw maca, I don't feel the effects as much as I do the non-raw version.
Do you have certain brands that you like?
Yeah, my favorite brand of maca, hands down. It is so potent. It's actually it's a 10X concentrate, really potent, has a really creamy caramel taste to it. It's really a good tasting maca, is the Longevity Power brand. Christian Bates is the guy. He's up in Northern California. He's a small batch producer. He does things like goji extract, maca root. He has Longevity in a Bottle is another awesome product of his. But check out Longevity Power, Christian
Link
Bates.
Down below.
His company is the best maca. It's more expensive than the other macas on the market, but because it's so potent, it's a 10X extract, you need to take less of it. So if you're going to try that out, I would actually recommend starting with a half a teaspoon to 1 teaspoon, no more than that.
And it's really wonderful in smoothies. It's great. You can make your own chocolates with it. What else do you put it in? I feel like smoothies is like the big thing. You can even put it in your coffee. If you're using like a really high quality organic fair trade coffee, you could put it in there. But if you're trying to get away from coffee to, of course, you know, try something different for energy, I think a smoothie is a great way to go. And for someone that's working long hours, try to see if you can find a refrigerator that you could store a smoothie in, and you can actually make it before you go in and keep it in like a mason jar. And a smoothie will last in the fridge. I mean, we have pre-made smoothies on the shelves now from all sorts of companies out there, so you can easily make yours right before you go to work, or even bring a personal blender if it's appropriate for you to whip up something and bring the ingredients with you.
Now,
but what else would you put maca in?
Oh, well, as far as maca goes, I pretty much stick to sweet or dessert-based things because, again, it has that nice caramel flavor.
Mm-hmm.
You could experiment maybe in things like a creamy soup, butternut squash soup, a pumpkin soup. I think that caramel undertone will go good there.
Yeah.
But I usually use maca in my sweet desserts. But
yeah,
in terms of energy, if you're trying to stay away from highly, highly coffee-based caffeinated beverages, one other product we really like. It's a little tough to find. You might need to order it on the internet. It's Shakti Chai.
Yes. Yes.
That's another one we like. And that's
is absolutely fabulous. It's just a blend. And does it have maca in it?
I'm gonna
go get it.
Yeah, actually. I think it does have maca. I think it's got a blend of things like guarana, which is another South American nut. So South America apparently is the place to be if you want really energizing superfoods. It's a great place, but so many ingredients.
Yes.
Whitney's going to read you the list.
This is one of my favorites, Shakti Chai, and
you
it comes in caffeinated or decaffeinated. And I find you might want to start off with the decaffeinated version of it and see if that gives you enough energy from the other ingredients. The list is so I'll just link to it down below and all of you can go look it up. But the taste is great. It's not too sweet. It used to be sweeter, but it's sweetened with coconut palm sugar, a little bit more. You could add some stevia if you'd like. I will have this hot or cold. I'll blend it in with some coconut milk or whatever favorite non-dairy milk that you have. You could just blend it with water, and it's just really, really lovely. It tastes like a hot chocolate meets a chai with all these great herbs. It's very herby. So you definitely, if you're expecting like a traditional chai, it's not going to quite be like. Why don't you read off a few ingredients? Because I want to grab one other thing to show you.
Sure guys. Thing. So in terms of clean caffeine, like I like to say, you know, not all caffeinated ingredients are created equal. So in here we've got things like ginseng, which is awesome for energy. So you've got Chinese Panax ginseng, you've got Fo Ti, which is also known as He Shou Wu, which is an awesome Chinese herb. You've got goji in here. Cordyceps is great too.
Let's not read the whole list.
I'm just giving them a few though. I'm giving them
the whole time to read it all. But yes, and funny you mentioned that because a lot of the same ingredients are in this next product. Mm-hmm. This is my go-to product when I really need an instant boost of energy. I'm not a big coffee drinker. I kind of like the taste of coffee, but I've never been that into it. And it can be really acidic for your body unless you get a low acidic coffee. And those are coming more and more popular. Of course, you also want to look for the organic and fair trade to be good to the workers and the environment if you're going to choose to have coffee. But since I don't prefer coffee, I usually go for tea or herbs. And this Energy Matrix, NRG Matrix, and again, all of this stuff will be linked down below for all of you to check this out, is basically the equivalent of a Red Bull or something. It gives you such a blast of energy within minutes, and you just mix this into water. Kind of tastes like Tang.
It does taste like
Tang. It's very orangey, and it's sweetened with stevia, I believe. There's no actual sugar in it. I think, let's see.
No, I think it's just stevia
and monk fruit.
Oh, great.
Yeah, so all low glycemic, unrefined, no actual strong sweeteners. I mean, like sugar, there's just those type of sweeteners. Plus, it's got immune support. It's got vitamin D, vitamin C, vitamin B, and some really great blends in here, mushroom blend. So mushrooms have a lot of really great benefits as well. A little bit goes a long way. Both of these products are on the pricier side. I think this was about $30. Mm-hmm. And I think this was probably around the same. But this has 91 servings in it for $30. Lasts a long time. And this one has 33 servings in it. So even if it's a dollar per serving, if you're getting that great high quality energy boost, that's excellent.
Contrast that for a moment with your $5 to $6 latte at your Starbucks,
or even your $2 Red Bull. You know, and that you're taking in all these artificial ingredients and not feeling that great afterwards. These are giving you a sustained energy plus all the nutrients of the other ingredients that are in them, and that's why I prefer them. I will say though, it's all going to be personal preference. I have recommended this to some people, and they either don't like the taste or they don't like the way that they feel. So it's an experiment. One size doesn't fit all, mm-hmm. as we talked about in the first Q&A with Jason, is really figuring out what works best, feels right, what's easy to get, you know. A lot of these, I can find this one locally. This I've only found in Massachusetts, but they're both available online. And mm-hmm. if you live in a different country, it might be a little bit more challenging. So if you have some more recommendations, let us know in the YouTube comments once this video is up recorded. So I hope that answers your question, Lisa. And I think you're watching today. So if you are, chime in later when we open up to the live Q&A. Thank you for asking that. So Jane asked a great question. She said, I've heard a lot from vegans about concerns about calcium, vitamin B12, but as someone returning to veganism after a long time away, I want an all-round supplement, something to ensure that I'm getting everything I need. I take a woman's supplement as I generally have bad periods, but I also know that in the past, veganism has helped with the pain to some extent. I'd love to know any trusted vegan women's supplements available in the UK, etc. I'm also worried about my level of calcium, and I don't know where to start looking into all of that. She also wanted to know if I could recommend overall health books aside from Alicia Silverstone or Colleen Patrick-Goudreau, as she's read them all. And so I want to jump in real quick. We've definitely talked about this a bunch of times, and we touched upon it a lot. So number one, because we've gone so much in depth, I'm going to condense the answer today. If you go to the Eco Vegan Gal YouTube page, there's a magnifying glass that you can click on and type in a word. So if you type in the word supplement, it will link to any videos where I've talked about supplements, and you can hear different perspectives that I've had over the years. But really this past year in the Q&A, it's just come up a lot. So first and foremost, I really try to encourage people to supplementing as much as possible. Jason's going to give a different perspective to that, but I really want to start with that. We talked about in our other video about how not all one size fits all. Hi, Evie. And it's very important for each of you to consult with a medical professional and as soon as possible get a really comprehensive blood test done to figure out what you need, because each of us are different and they're requiring different things. So for the most part, or the majority of the part here, you can get a lot of the nutrients that you need from plants. And I have a few great books here that I wanted to reference. One that I think is a phenomenal reference, and since Jane also asked about new books, The Forks Over Knives Plan just came out. And I haven't made my way through most of the book yet, but I have read the first few chapters. And within it, the authors, Alana Polday and Matthew Lederman, who were in Forks Over Knives, really well-respected authors, they talk about how they don't believe in taking supplements and how supplements can also be dangerous. And they've got some research to back it up. So I really recommend this to everyone. I've been meaning to talk about this book anyways, and I'm gonna read more of it, but it's really based on foods to eat. So if you're looking for nutrient dense foods to eat and something that's gonna really give you what you buy choice, plus of course it supports your whole lifestyle and it's from a very good health perspective. I'll talk more about this once I've finished. Then I have another new book that just came out called Shred It from Robert Cheek. And this is really interesting because Robert is a plant-based athlete, a vegan athlete. He's been a bodybuilder. He's competed. I mean, he has such an amazing history and knowledge base. He's worked with the Forks Over Knives people. He knows so many people in the health world. And he just released this book to help teach people how to burn fat and build muscle on a whole foods plant-based diet. And there's another question today that this is probably going to help answer. Highly recommend it. Self-published, so all the money that you spend when you buy this book goes to Robert to support him. He's really a phenomenal guy. But the reason I bring him up now is that he's actually moved away from advising supplements and even what's the word I'm looking for? The protein drinks, the protein powders and all of that. He used to be a big advocate for that and he started to move away. I'm not sure how in depth he gets in this book yet because I've only made it a little ways in, but it's such a phenomenal book for Jane. And again, he's another person who advocates for not relying on supplements. Lastly, though, if you do want to learn more about supplements, one book I haven't read yet, but based on the description, it's been sitting on my bookshelf here, and I think that this could be a good resource for some of you. I don't believe it has a vegan message per se, but I find it really interesting. It's called The Supplement Pyramid, Supplement Pyramid, How to Build Your Personalized Nutritional Regimen. Now, I cannot entirely recommend this because I literally haven't even read a page of this, but from the description and flipping through it, it sounds like a really interesting book. So you can check back in with me. I'll try to give a look at this soon. I mean, he definitely talks about real food versus processed foods and chemicals, artificial things and all of that. So those are the three books I would recommend, and just getting yourself thinking about what your body needs, using foods as much as possible. And if you're taking in supplements, using the guidance of someone knowledgeable like this that can help you figure out what you need, okay? So what is your summary? Maybe if you have anything additional to offer based on what we were talking about in the last Q&A.
In terms of the first supplementation?
Yes, because like, yeah. I said, that one, you went way into depth on that. So we're not going to do that today, but I want to add and maybe an update that you've experienced, because it's been a few months now.
Yeah, I agree with everything that Whitney had to say in that this is such an individual exploration of what's going to work optimally for you. So for me to say that conscientious and directed by an MD supplementation is bad, I don't agree with that, because what I'm currently experiencing is a supplementation program right now. I went to go get a blood test. Again, you can look at the last Q&A to get in depth about this. I was put on a supplementation program because certain nutrients that I was eating from plant-based, my body was not converting or assimilating them in a high enough ratio. So things like D3, I'm taking vitamin D3 drops, things like omega-3, things like magnesium, which again goes back to the whole calcium thing. That's a whole other thing we can talk about. But if you're wanting to build calcium, you don't take calcium supplements. You take magnesium, because research has found that magnesium converts to calcium in the body. So what you want to do is actually increase your magnesium levels, not take an isolated calcium supplement, because an isolated calcium supplement can cause a whole other host of issues. So you want to actually focus on magnesium that will convert to calcium. But anyway, with my thing is, I think you definitely have to invest in the blood test. So you're not, again, my analogy is throwing darts at a dartboard with a blindfold on. Oh, maybe I need B12. Maybe I need calcium. Maybe I need K2. You're never really going to know until you get that test done. So investing that money will actually help guide you on your nutrition program and whether or not supplementation is right for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I think you would probably really like this book now that I'm having a chance to go through it. I mean, it's, he says right here, the common question, I eat a pretty healthy diet. Do I really need to take supplements? And this doctor says yes. So ultimately, I really think it's important for everybody to, again, figure out what works best for you, but also look at a variety of sources. So you've got the forks over knives perspective, or the, you know, these doctors, maybe not all of forks over knives, but this specific book saying supplements aren't necessary. And Robert Cheek saying, you know, protein powders aren't necessary. And now then you've got the way other side where a doctor like Michael A. Smith here says supplements are necessary, and you're finding that as well. So it really is important to just consider both perspectives, talk to a medical professional about what your specific place, your needs are, and make it happen. And in terms of some just store-bought stuff that you can buy, one of my team members recently wrote a fantastic review on Alicia Silverstone's new supplement line. And It really sounds fantastic, because they formulated this supplement to be based on all whole foods. Mm-hmm. And it's one of very few supplements that is just very whole foods based that I'm aware of. So high quality ingredients. I'll link to that review down below, or you can go to ecovegangal.com to find that. And I haven't had personal experience with it yet, because I don't take very many supplements, but the one that I'll take from time to time is Sun Warrior's raw supplements. I mean, they have a great women's formula there, but I've never had a doctor, I haven't talked to a doctor yet about whether it's necessary or potentially harmful for me, because those one size fits all capsules, it's like they just kind of put everything in there. It's not customized to you. Yes. So it could be dangerous, you know, going with what they talk about in this book, is that you might be taking too much of something that you don't need, which is not only a waste of money, but it might be stressing out your body in some way. So I think it can be dangerous, and that's why I just try not to recommend supplements. I really hope that each of you take the time to dig in and find what you need there.
Yeah, so you can invest your money wisely. Mm-hmm. Because much like foods, I do believe, just to, as a last point, supplements are not created equal. And the ones that are made from raw whole food ingredients, they're much better. They're higher potency. Your body assimilates them more efficiently, and therefore you're going to pay a higher price. But Again, if you're investing in your health, you're putting the money in, you're taking a targeted, conscientious approach, you want to invest the money in a high quality supplement so it's actually doing its job.
Right, right. And you've been taking individual supplements, not just a combined.
Not a multivitamin.
Yeah, not a multi. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, because you want, again, you need to know on an individual level what's right for you.
And it's a lot more work, and it might be a little bit more expensive, but that's why consulting with a doctor, a nutritionist, a dietitian, someone that can really guide you towards what you need there.
Yeah, and you're going to feel better. I feel a lot better.
If you're looking for somewhere to start and you're not sure where, maybe you want to try out doing a virtual consultation, highly recommend reaching out to our friend Juliana Hever, the plant-based dietitian. She's a great place to start with anything plant-based nutrition related. Now she does these virtual consulting sessions. So I believe you can work with her from wherever you are in the world, and I'll link to her down below. I just adore her. She's so knowledgeable, and if she doesn't have the answer, she can point you towards someone that will. And that way you don't have to worry, like, because sometimes we get held back if we can't find the answer right away, or we're scared, and it'll take us months and months to figure out a solution. Don't try not to do that. It's the holidays. You could ask for this as a gift. Maybe somebody that loves you, say, hey, I want to do some virtual sessions with Juliana or someone like her. That would be a great gift to get from somebody, right? I mean, why not ask for that? Okay. Next question comes from Pamela. Pamela says she's looking for high fiber and protein recipes. She works 15 hours a day and runs every morning and needs recipes to keep her full and going. She doesn't use a microwave at work, so she needs everything to last in her lunchbox with a cold pack and a thermos. So anything come, I mean, the great thing is almost every plant-based, whole foods plant-based recipe is going to be high in fiber. So that's really, really simple. I mean, most vegetables, brown rices, I mean, pretty much all the basic components, legumes, those are going to be really high in fiber and in protein. Mm-hmm. Almost every single plant-based source has protein in it. But yeah. What are some of your favorite recipes that are very high in both?
I mean, immediately, if you go to your seeds and your legumes, hemp seeds, very high in protein, 33% protein, very high in fiber. Quinoa.
Well, do you have any specific recipes? So Jason has a phenomenal library of video recipes on his channel. So any recent videos that you feel are like a really great meal, an easy meal that will last a while? I mean, I'm thinking like sandwiches. Maybe a salad, you can keep the dressing separate.
Here, I mean, an easy thing to do is I'll give you three things, right? Quinoa is amazing. You get a tricolor quinoa. You're getting all of your antioxidants because you're getting black, red, and white quinoa. Very high in protein, very easy to digest, high in fiber. But actually, if you put some broccoli, steamed broccoli on there, that's actually up to 40% protein by weight. People don't know that, broccoli and cauliflower. Even if you got a little bit of tempeh, some marinated tempeh, you could put that on too. Again, very high in protein. So one of my classic recipes is a tempeh and broccoli curry bowl with quinoa. Ooh. You can find that recipe online.
So just look up Jason Robel on YouTube.
Yeah, curry and broccoli. Very simple, very easy, 15, 20 minutes at the most. Other great things too, if you decide to take a protein supplement, I do love Sun Warrior. They have a natural flavor that has a completely neutral taste that you can bake with, you can cook with. I've made soup bases out of it, salad dressings. I've put it in pancakes or baked goods. That's a great way to bump up the protein content. One level scoop, I think, is 19 grams of protein, and it's a 98.6 correlation to the assimilability of whey protein. So that means your body can recognize and assimilate over 98% of that protein. So you're getting most of those 19 grams. So try cooking with that. Tastes great, thickens things up. It's awesome. And
you've got a supreme kale BLT salad here.
That's a good way.
So that would, you could just do, get all the components together and put the dressing separate. And the BLT is made from tempeh, I'm guessing, or mm-hmm. the bacon part of
it's
it.
It's tempeh bacon. Mm-hmm.
So you get a lot of protein from that. And the kale has so many nutrients, including fiber. That one's great. That's right on his channel. So we'll
edamame is great too. Edamame hummus is very easy. If you get a non-GMO organic edamame, any kind of fermented or organic soy, non-GMO is also great. Very high in amino acids and protein as well. Mm-hmm.
So many options. I mean, in a way, there's just an abundance of this, of choices for you. But if you're looking for specific recipes, check out his site, check out his website, and you even have the free ebook. I'm sure there's tons of great recipes in there. Mm-hmm. But the good news is that fiber and protein are just incredibly simple. You just want to look for things that are going to hold up. And a thermos is great. Soups, any plant-based soup is just going to be loaded with nutrients in it when it's made of whole foods and not a lot of processed ingredients. So that's what I would say. Mm-hmm. Okay. So how do you feel? This one comes from Amber. How do you feel about eating good all week and then having a vegan cheat date? Pros and cons. What are some healthy raw vegan cheat meals?
Interesting. You know, if I may, I think the whole concept of cheating psychologically is an interesting thing. This whole thing of like cheat day. I see that a lot on Instagram and social media of people, you know, in the fitness community, in the natural living community. I'll just expand it beyond vegan, you know, like, yeah, man, did it all week. I'm going to have my cheat day. And it's like, what is the psychology behind this?
My YOLO.
What is the psychology behind this? It's, I mean, if I may go off for a moment, I think it's like, what is it, this desire that I'm going to be bad. I'm going to be naughty. I'm going to do something wrong. It's like, what the F is this? I'm sorry, but it's like, if you honor your choices, you're never going to have to call it a cheat day. So like my version of something is, it's like this. I'm very clear that what I'm going to put in my body is going to make me feel like good or feel like crap. I'm very aware of that. So I choose not to put things in my body that are going to make me feel like absolute crap because I'm not willing to have that trade-off, right? So I find it interesting that people are like, I'm going to work really hard 5 or 6 days a week, and then I'm going to eat something that's going to make me feel like crap. It's just a fascinating psychology. But if you're going to have a cheat day, okay, here's what I do. I reach for an organic dark chocolate bar. So good, right? There's so many now that are sweetened with coconut palm sugar, that are sweetened with stevia.
I'm going to interrupt you because I know that's not true. I see him cheat all the time when it comes to food. When you go out to eat or when you go to events, you have your cheats. You eat gluten even though you don't normally eat gluten, and you'll eat some forms of sugar even though you don't consider those cheats.
No, because I don't feel like death afterward. I don't feel like death afterward.
I disagree. I've seen you many times eat foods that you don't feel that great afterwards, and as you're eating them, you will say, I know I'm not going to feel that good. But it's what's interesting.
2 years ago.
No, I'm calling him out. We disagree here. I see you do this frequently, but my point being is that to your point is that these foods are still good for you. They just might not digest them well. That's what I'm bringing up. So we both are very similar in the sense that we have foods that we just don't digest well. Like for me, it's corn, it's soy, mm-hmm. it's gluten, it's almonds. But I will still cheat. That's what my cheat is. My cheat is eating those foods that I know my body doesn't handle well. So I'll eat them and I know that I'm going to have whatever sensitivity reaction that I have afterwards. And that's what I'm saying is you do that pretty frequently. You'll eat something because you just want to try it. So maybe you're not considering it cheating per se.
Exactly.
But you know that you're not going to feel as good as you would as if you had not eaten it. And that might be like a refined sugar.
Yes.
Every once in a while you come across a really great vegan product that's made with a refined sugar. So I think it's important to define. Maybe you just don't define that as cheating.
I don't define it.
But I think some people would define that as cheating. Right. And that's why I bring that up.
The point that I make is this. If you're going to stray away from, I guess, the core of your dietary preference, that's okay. But the energy you put on things when you say I'm having my cheat day is you're putting a negative energy on it. If I'm going to eat something, I'm not going to be like, oh God, I'm being a bad person about this. I hate myself. And my point is that people will use those things to put negative energy on the food, which that's not good, or direct negative energy on themselves.
Yeah.
Like I'm being bad, right? I know I'm being bad. And I'll hear people say like, oh, I know I'm being bad right now. You don't want to live that way. It's not a healthy relationship psychologically to have with your food or with yourself. Mm-hmm. So if it's a cheat day, here's my recommendation. Enjoy the heck out of it, right? Like really honor your choice, honor the moment, and don't beat yourself up for it.
Well, sure, but maybe it doesn't have to be a whole day. That's the other thing. It's like the other reason
I brought a cheat meal
or cheat taste. I mean, for me, you know, again, sometimes I'll just taste something, but I agree. I never think about it in terms of cheating because cheating to me would be more if it wasn't vegan, but I wouldn't, you know, like that to me is more defining the cheat than eating sugary or oil or whatever. And I think this question also is centered around the raw diet, and some people feel there is some cheating there. And I think that's why the raw till 4 has become kind of popular, is because raw foodists would feel that they were cheating if they had cooked foods. Mm-hmm. And that's really interesting too. And it's fascinating to see that the raw till 4 diet has become so popular, because clearly these people that are doing that diet want to be able to eat cooked foods. And so now they're like, okay, I'll eat raw all day long until 4 o'clock, and then I can finally eat my cooked food. And it's interesting. Yeah. I mean, if that's, some people really enjoy that, and it's a great way if you need that structure there. But if you want to be a little bit more loose and eat cooked foods or raw foods whenever you want. The second part of that question was, do you have any favorite raw cheat foods? So now that we're moving away from the word cheat, how about we say indulgent? What are some good indulgent raw foods? Like, I mean, it's hard to say without this person being here live what they meant exactly, but I mean, some, cause like they said,
I've got one.
Go ahead.
Here's the ultimate. Ready? Hands down. I'm going to give a shout out.
Indulgent raw food is?
Gem, nut butters.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
If you, you know what? If you want raw nut butter crack, that's what they call it. People are calling it like raw crack. Seriously. This stuff, they make these blends of these superfood nut butters with hazelnut butter and almond butter. And it is the creamiest nut butter. First of all, the texture is amazing. It's the creamiest nut butter you've ever had.
Yeah.
But they'll infuse it with superfoods. And it is, yeah. There
so
you go.
Good.
There's your raw cheat day.
Even that, to butter. Me, it doesn't feel like a cheat. The only cheat that I feel there, the tension I feel is they're so expensive. They're like $14.
Well, it's eating the whole thing.
And I could literally eat the entire jar. I think there's 6 servings supposedly in there. But
six servings.
That would be one or maybe two. I can stretch it sometimes. It's expensive. So it's a budget cheat for me. But it's not a food cheat because they're all made with such high quality ingredients. And that's the thing. I can't even think of any raw food that's a cheat. I mean, maybe nuts or maybe
higher fat stuff,
higher fat, higher sugar. But
sure.
Even so, it's so high quality. I suppose it's more like, what do you want to strive for? And what is your norm? And when you go outside the norm. So if you're on a low fat raw foods diet, of course, like lots of nuts and, you know, like fully raw Christina, her cheats are going to be very different than
our cheats,
yeah. You know, like, she hadn't had, I remember when she had chocolate for the first time in a while. That was, I think, at the Raw Living Expo.
That's right.
And this was like a huge deal. She doesn't eat chocolate normally. So to her, that felt like a cheat because she doesn't normally eat it and she doesn't feel that good on chocolate. So it's just so, so relative and it's figuring out what works best for you, but trying not to make it too tense, right? You
yes.
want to enjoy life. You want to enjoy your food.
Yes.
You want to feel good emotionally and physically. So just go with the flow. And if you have a day where you feel a little off and you feel like you cheated, you can get right back on track the next day. And trust me, it'll all go very smoothly. Okay. Well, let me see here. So somebody that wanted to remain anonymous asked this question. She said, I am a 15-year-old girl that was vegetarian for 2 years. I was really proud of my accomplishment. I felt alive, healthy, and happy, as well as great about myself. In April 2014, I lost track and stopped being a vegetarian because I felt that my family was disapproving of my lifestyle. Any suggestions on how I can get back on track and help ease them into me being a vegetarian and possibly a vegan again? So this is another very popular topic, and if you type the word family into the Eco Vegan Gal YouTube page, you will find this comes up a lot. Family is like such a common thing. And it's something that Jason can't, well, I guess we could both relate to it, but your family has been incredibly accepting. My family's been very accepting about my choices, but there's still resistance in there. So again, we could spend an entire hour just talking about dealing with family and all of that. It's just like always a hot topic here. To ease back into the lifestyle is really just to figure out why you want to do it and coming up with a plan. It's just like anything else. It's turning it into a habit. It's having some sort of motivation there. But I think it's also really about being supported. And that's really my main motivation through Eco Vegan Gal is supporting everybody here. Because I know many of you watching out there don't have family that supports you or don't know any friends. And I feel very passionate to let you know that you're not alone. Not only do you have me, but you have everyone else in the Eco Vegan Gal community supporting you. So maybe looking out for that virtual support there if you don't have it from family or friends nearby. So find motivation and find support and come up with a plan for yourself. And there are just an abundance of resources. I will continue providing as many resources from myself and recommending resources. Like, of course, this book is great, right? It's called The Forks Over Knives Plan. It's basically the vegan plan here. And it's all about making over your life for 4 weeks and it's guiding you through with recipes and details and all of that. You know, this to me is much more centered around if you're trying to focus on your health and to, you know, I feel like this might go for a little bit more of an older crowd. For 15-year-olds, I would look to someone like Alicia Silverstone or the Skinny Bitch series, or who else is really
Talia
good?
Talia Furman's new book.
Talia Furman's new book. I can pull out. It's on my shelf somewhere. But yes, that is right here, actually. Very convenient. This book is so, so wonderful. I had her on as a guest, so check out the Q&A with Talia. And it's all geared towards young women. And if you pick up something like this, you're going to feel like Talia sitting next to you, talking with you. She's now starting to do videos on her channel, and she's got an abundance of resources and knowledge. So I would say that would be my number one recommendation, is find someone, whether it's Talia or someone like her, that you really can relate to. And of course, I'm here for you too. And just indulge in that. Just, you know, you can come to my channel every day and watch my videos. You can go to hers. You can read books. Surround yourself with that information so you feel supported. And ultimately, letting go of whatever anyone else has to say. If you feel good about your decision, that's all that really matters. And it's such a hard thing for us, but we just need to remind ourselves that on a daily basis. Make it your mantra or something. If you have the knowledge, if you feel good, if you look good, if you're thriving on something, if it feels like the right decision for you, it does not matter what other people think. And I know that's very hard with family, but starting to understand that as early on as possible is so important. And ultimately, family is deep down, even if they're resistant, deep down, they really want the best for you. So it's just a matter of them getting used to it. So it's going to differ from family to family, from situation to situation in terms of how you all relate, right? But I think that it's just a matter of adapting towards it. And maybe you have to do the journey on your own, or if your family's open to it and they want to learn along with you, you can read a book together, you can watch videos or documentaries together. It's going to differ from case to case there.
Yeah, I mean, for me, you know, I think really it's, you have to just live in accordance with your highest truth. And, you know, I always feel like good food, though, is the great equalizer. And even if they're not ready in this particular moment, if you want to learn how to make recipes on YouTube, or there's literally hundreds of thousands of amazing vegan recipes for free on the internet, great recipe books. Even at 15, if you start learning how to make your own food now, and you may have to if your family's not that supportive yet, when you learn how to make a really great vegan pizza or cauliflower buffalo wings or great burgers, mom and dad might start to go like, all right, I'll try it. And you know what? All right, I'll try it is a great moment. It's a wonderful moment.
Yes.
Because that's your opportunity to take everything you've learned and just let the food do the talking, let the love you put into it do the talking. So I really feel strongly that just living by example is the most powerful thing you can do.
Absolutely.
And empowering yourself with that knowledge and that skill to be able to live how you want to live, make the food you want to make for yourself.
So one last question before we get into the live questions. So to prepare everyone who's waiting to ask live, you can ask live questions at any point, and they all get they just sit there in the Q&A app until we look at them, and you can actually vote them up. So if you don't have a question, but you want to see what other people are asking, you can go click like the plus one sign symbol on Google, and that'll vote up the question so that we'll answer them in order. And again, as a reminder, ask them on the Google Plus event Q&A app. So you go to the Google Plus event, which you can find on Facebook, Twitter, or the Eco Vegan Gal Google Plus page. Open that up, open up the window so you can see the video. And then on the right-hand side, there's a Q&A app, and this is accessible on computer or mobile device. And that's where we're going to start answering questions. But this one person submitted four questions, and for this one specifically, asked to remain anonymous. So I'm going to answer that one question because it feels like it might be the most important. So what do you recommend in this situation for Thanksgiving? You're going to a friend's home and they are heavy meat eaters. Yes, you are going to bring a vegan dish, but that's really not enough to satisfy your hunger for a full day and an evening there. This person wants to be able to participate in holiday eating without sneaking snacks on the ride there or in the bathroom. It's just not as fun on a special holiday. Suggestions. It's, you know, holidays are always tricky, and this is a great transition from the last question to this one, because family, friends, whoever you're spending time with on the holidays, some people are just judgmental, or some people are stuck in their way, and some are very set on thinking that vegan food is not good. And it's funny, I just posted on Facebook the other day this great image where, you know, people always say, well, I don't eat vegan food, but so much of our food is vegan or even just vegetarian. And that same goes with Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you what we're doing for Thanksgiving with our friends. So us being best friends and having so many mutual friends, we thought we're going to get together and have a group of great people. And they're all, actually, they're not all vegan, mm-hmm. but most, all of them are very open to veganism, right? I suggested that everyone bring a vegan, gluten-free dish. That way everybody can enjoy it. And almost everything that we have, or I think everything we have, is traditional. So my point being here, listen to this list. These are all traditional Thanksgiving foods. So mashed potatoes and gravy, staple of Thanksgiving. Those can easily be vegan. Stuffing can easily be vegan and gluten-free. Pumpkin pie, cranberry sauce, root vegetables. You're going to do Brussels sprouts. We're having someone do, like, you know, carrots. We've got yams. Those can easily be vegan. Even marshmallows, right? You can find vegan marshmallows. Your drinks, you know, you can do cider, eggnog, easily vegan now. Eggnog there. What else? I mean, all of those, aside from the turkey, pretty much every single Thanksgiving side dish can be made vegan, gluten-free, soy-free, even raw. Salads. I mean, on and on. There's so many options. I've actually had a raw Thanksgiving one year and it was great. You know, you can do mashed potatoes. You could, or instead of mashed potatoes, you can do cauliflower. You can do, the celery root can be made. And, you know, like, there's so many different ways that you can make incredible dishes no matter what your dietary preference is. So my number one advice is to just bring a bunch of side dishes that everyone can enjoy. And as the person with supposedly the most dietary preferences, you might have to bring a lot of food with you, but you can share it with everyone and not say a word about it being vegan. They don't need to know that the mashed potatoes don't have milk or butter in them. They don't need to know that the stuffing is made with a vegan bread and a vegan veggie broth. You know, they don't need to know that the cranberry sauce, it doesn't have any refined sugar in it. They don't need to know that the yams or the marshmallows you're using, like, nobody needs to know any of that because it's going to taste so good. So if you're okay with being at an event with turkey, bring like 3 or 4 side dishes, big or small portions, however much you want to share. And then you can continuously eat all of that food along with everyone else. And they're already expecting you not to eat the turkey. It's not a big deal. That's what I would do. And it doesn't need to take that much time. You could also, if you don't want to spend the time or you don't feel confident about your kitchen skills, Whole Foods has an amazing selection of pre-made vegan dishes, pretty much everything that I just mentioned. And most natural markets, restaurants, like in Los Angeles, of course, we have an abundance, but most major cities have a vegan restaurant, and almost all of them will offer Thanksgiving meals to go. Mm-hmm. So you could pick up some of that and bring that to an event. It's going to be much more expensive that way, but it's going to take a lot less time. You don't have to worry about the gourmet aspect of it.
Well said. Let the food do the talking.
Well, any other tips about it that come to mind? Maybe other... Because we've all been to Thanksgivings that were not vegan.
Yeah, I've done, you know, the Thanksgiving at the house. I've done Thanksgiving when I moved away and couldn't go. I don't go home to Detroit for Thanksgiving. I always spend Thanksgiving away. So I've done it both. I've mm-hmm. come to parties that the host was not vegan, the family wasn't vegan. So I brought my own food. And inevitably, one year, the people I didn't really even know that well, even their parents were like, well, like, can I try some of that? And I remember at that year, I actually had jicama cauliflower mashed potatoes. I had like marinated raw green beans. Actually, that was one year I did a raw Thanksgiving. And if you show up with really good food and you don't make a big deal out of it, right? Because it's energy. It's not showing up like in this oppositional thing of like, I'm going to sit here and eat my vegan meal and bleh. But you're in this mood of sharing and you're coming with a positive energy and you're really excited about the food. Inevitably, I found people want to try it. Mm-hmm. Because good food is good food.
Yeah.
And if you come up with kick butt meals that smell and look amazing, people will want to try it. Trust me.
Oh yeah. And trust they're so, mashed potatoes are one of the simplest dishes you could make. You cut up some potatoes, boil them in water, mash them up, and add in whatever. You could use coconut butter. You could use Earth Balance. You could use whatever you want. Gravy's easy. I mean, those can take you no time to make, but everybody loves mashed potatoes, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, keep it familiar, because if you show up with a tofurkey, it's really not how you want to do your lead-in, I think. You want to bring familiarity, because familiarity is what brings the openness and people willing to try things.
Yes.
If you're making things too outside of the box, you might be met with that opposition and that fear and that pushback.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. But on that note, if you go to a place like Whole Foods, they have multiple vegan meat alternatives out mm-hmm. there now. Tofurkey.
Field roast.
Gardein field roast. Hillary's now has a great gluten-free, soy-free, organic stuffing in a pan. I mean, mm-hmm. there's at least 3 to 5. There's also, there's another one that is meant to look like a turkey. I forget what that company is called. It's probably a soy-based, but it's like a big vegan turkey alternative that you can get. I've never really enjoyed those. And also, you know, the food's a little bit too processed for me. But if you like that, you can bring it. Why not? I mean, for years I used to eat that stuff, and mm-hmm. I liked the idea of eating something meat-like, because I felt kind of like I was more part of the Thanksgiving experience. And since I grew up eating turkey, it was easier for me the first few years that I was mm-hmm. vegan to eat something turkey-like, even though it tasted nothing like. My first Thanksgiving, I will never forget. It was, I had tofurkey for the first time, and I thought to myself, what have I done? How am I going to be a vegan? This is awful. But I actually, over years, I grew fond of tofurkey, and I think the recipe's gotten better. Now we have so many options. The other thing I was going to say is that thinking about other options for yourself. Every Thanksgiving's been a little bit different for me, but the best thing that I found is having a potluck with like-minded people. So we talked about doing a potluck together, and then we started thinking, let's invite other people. And then we were invited to somebody else's home where they were going to have a turkey. And we had a conversation thinking, do we feel comfortable going to someone's home where there's a turkey, or would we rather go somewhere where there's not? And we chose not to. We chose to be around, to have it fully vegan, at a friend's house, a small little gathering, no family, just a bunch of people celebrating each other. And we also have a friend who is going to come after he celebrates with his family, which is cool too. This will be the second time that he's done that. Mm-hmm. I think that's a great idea. You could go to the family or friends turkey Thanksgiving, spend a few hours with them, and then you can go to a vegan Thanksgiving or host one with your friends, so you get the best of both worlds. So there's so many options. In Los Angeles, they have a massive public vegan potluck out here. So if you don't have one of those in your area, you could start one and make an annual tradition. I mean, there's so many ways to start making it easy, because you're probably not the only vegan in your area, even if you think so. So check out meetup.com, you know, start talking to people on Facebook, or just start something yourself.
Well said.
I'm really excited for Thanksgiving.
Me too.
Really
excited. It's really close. It's like, it's becoming real now.
I would love to hear from people in the comment section. What is your favorite Thanksgiving recipe? I'm going to be making a gluten-free vegan stuffing. And last year, I think I made it with like butternut squash and cranberries and nuts. And I just got some gluten-free bread, chopped it up, put some veggie broth on it, I mixed it up with butternut squash and cranberries and orange. I had put some fresh orange juice in there. It was so easy to make, but there are so many flavors. It was awesome. So now I want to hear from you. And stay tuned on Facebook. I'll usually post a few recipes on Facebook, like roundups and stuff, if you're looking for more ideas. But I would love to hear from you on YouTube. Let's open it up to live questions, shall we?
Bring them all.
You can direct the questions to both of us, one of us, on any topic you want.
Evie, too.
We are here, yep.
She's always willing to answer questions in the background.
Oh, shoot. I just realized I didn't turn on the Q&A app this whole time. All right. Well, my apologies. I made a mistake while setting up the Q&A. That's so weird. I thought it was automatic. I'm going to do things a little bit differently. I'm going to take some questions from the group here. I so apologize. Google Plus.
It's going to go away soon anyway.
No, I don't think it's going to go away. I think that they just really need some help because I didn't turn on the Q&A app before we started and now I cannot turn it on. So we're actually going to take questions from the Google Plus app. And so I feel sad that I told everybody this whole time to do something you couldn't do. But I do see one that came in. So let me just real quick before I answer this question, explain how we're going to do things today a little bit differently. So you're now going to ask your questions on the page. Normally I say not to do that, but because of this error, we're going to do it this way. So you just go to the page and it's like the screen with a little video at the top and it's you can see questions coming in there. There's one from Sarah that I'm about to answer right now. And I'll also go over to YouTube and see if there are any questions that have come in there. I really apologize, everyone. So Sarah asked, what are your daily workout routines like? I love this question. Let's start with you.
I don't have a daily workout routine. Yep. There you go. I'm slacking right now. Like, I'll be real with you. I've been busy. It's an excuse, but I was actually doing a ton of traveling last month and I fell off the wagon. It was like, I literally in all of October was home a total of 8 days the whole month. And I was like, you know what? The first thing to go was working out. I was so busy with work and with traveling and with events. And, my intention though is to go back to kind of creating a hybrid of things for me when I am working out consistently. What I like to do is really a hybrid of things. I like to go on walks. We have so many amazing trails here, really great, challenging trails in the LA area. So it's a combination of hiking, yoga, or Pilates. But one thing I actually want to dial back in the new year is weight training. As much as I love the yoga and Pilates, I don't feel like I have as much muscle tone as I did like 2 years ago when I was weight training. And I want to dial that back in. I want to increase my strength. I want to increase my muscle tone. So for me, it's important though to have a balance because for me, weight training is very young, aggravating. I'm already, if you know me and see my videos, a very high energy, passionate person. So doing something that really, really gets me going is a little bit imbalancing. So for me, it's something like the yoga, Pilates, hiking with the weight training that creates a nice balance energetically for me. So when I am on my game, that's what I do. But I'm not on my game right now at all.
It happens. I
did yoga today though.
Yes. So for me, I schedule yoga every single day of the week. And when I say schedule, I mean it's on my schedule, but I don't always make it. I had 2 days off this week. I feel for me personally, I need the most consistent exercise routine possible because otherwise I'll just start slacking. So I have to put it on my calendar and make room for it every day. And if I'm not able to make it, maybe my schedule's off, or maybe, you know, I'm really tired and I have like a really solid excuse for it that I won't go. It's been an evolving thing. I personally find yoga to be the most satisfying for me, and it works for me both from a mental and physical standpoint, but it's also not always quite getting the results that I need. And yoga can be so many different things, and there are different types of yoga. So, you know, you can do hot yoga, you can do vinyasa flow, you can do Iyengar like I did earlier today, and you can do restorative, and some of these are going to work for your body. I just feel like as long as I'm stretching, as long as I'm really getting into my body, getting tuned into my body, and doing something for it every day is great. So on the days that I don't make it to yoga, I try to take a long walk or even go for a run. In September, I was running almost every single day. And even when I was on the cruise, I ran around the edge of the cruise and just taking 10 or 15 minutes to run. It felt awesome. And I love the progress that I was making. So for me, it's very important. And coming back to the book I talked about earlier, mm-hmm. Robert's book, Shred It, is awesome. And Robert, if you're listening or watching, I love the way he writes about this. And this is something, sir, that you might appreciate is he really gets in and is like, if you want to see changes in results in your body, you need to commit to it. And he said, here it is. If you can't find 40 minutes a day to exercise because your 1,440 minutes each day are filled up with other things that are unsupportive of your goals, then clearly we know what your priorities are. There are 1,440 minutes each day. And he's just saying
40 minutes. So you have 1,400 minutes left.
That's a lot of time. It's a good trade-off. And if you're making excuses, then you're just making excuses. I mean, no offense, I'm not to pull you out here, but just because you're traveling doesn't mean that.
I know.
Doesn't mean, you know, Robert, for, he said to get to his bodybuilding goals, he did, he promised himself every single day he would be do 50 to 100 push-ups and 50 to 100 crunches every single day without excuse. And that only takes a few minutes to do that many. It's really not that much, but doing them every single day and having that consistency. So aiming for at least, I say 30 minutes to an hour of exercise every day, even if it's just going for a walk, walking up some stairs, taking your dog for a walk. I mean, so many different things, doing jumping jacks. Like, to me, it's like at least just something for like 15 minutes at the bare minimum is very important. And that's why yoga is on my schedule every day. I block out about 2 hours every day so I can walk to yoga, go to my class, walk back. And it's like very, very important to me. And I had just, like Robert was saying, making it a routine, a daily habit is the way that I feel my best and get the best results. And just no excuses. I'm about to release a video on Monday, I think, about this really great website called Grokker. And I'll talk all about it in this video. I'm really excited about it because it allows you to do fitness and yoga routines from home. And it's awesome. Is such an awesome site. So on the days that I couldn't make to yoga, I'm now going to start using this website to do some sort of fitness routine at home. And I think that helps take away the excuses. Because sometimes we just don't want to leave home. And I think that that is one of the challenges for you, is it's more the idea of just leaving the house that can be mentally aggravating.
Because it's like when I'm there
and
I'm in it, whether it's the gym or the yoga studio, I'm giving it. Like, I'm focused, I'm giving 100%, and I'm there very, very focused on my intention, which is awesome. But it's for me, it is the mental setup before I even walk out the door. Mm-hmm. It's the yoga studio that we were going to, Yoga Works, that one of the locations they had in Hollywood. It wasn't the class itself. It was, okay, I know I'm going to have to drive, it's going to be 30 minutes, do an hour and a half class, and then 30 minutes home.
Yeah.
And for me, it was the mental resistance of, do I want to commit that chunk of my day, not just to the actual yoga, but to the getting there, to the fighting traffic, to the yoga of traffic, which in LA is a thing.
Yes.
Actually. Yeah. And so that's it. So for me, I think it's especially revamping this is not only the variety for me to keep me interested and not creep into boredom, which is so easy for me my whole life to be bored with my workouts, but going someplace so close that the transit time is not even an issue anymore. Yes. It's like, I'm going, no doubt. And 15 minutes tops.
Yeah. My yoga studio is 15 minutes away walking, or 5 minutes, or like not even a 5 minute drive.
Driving.
It's awesome. And to his point, we both go to the same yoga studio, and that's actually great because going with somebody else, I find, is really, really helpful. So if you have a friend, family member, you know, anyone in your life that you want to take with you to a workout, feels so helpful. I mean, I feel responsible every day to encourage Jason. And a lot of times he doesn't feel like going, and that's fine. But I ask him almost every single day, you want to go to yoga today? And I think sometimes more than often, you will change your mind from a no to a yes simply because I encourage you to.
Well, yeah. And I think what that's good for me is that I want to be held accountable and encouraged. And both of those things are very different. Encouragement is someone in your life that wants to help hold you to your highest good because you know what's best for you, which is daily exercise. I know that's best for me, even though I don't do it. That's probably my biggest thing right now, honestly, is the discipline of knowing that this is good for me. And when I'm doing it, I see results. But the thing is having someone in your life that, thank you.
He's got it.
Thanks, Robert.
Book. Yeah. I wish Robert could be around. If Robert was around every single day, you would be doing at least 40 minutes.
Yeah, Robert, where are you? When are you coming back to
reading
LA?
Reading his book is so helpful for me. I mean, it's really inspired me. And like I said, I'm like a chapter into it. It's remarkable.
Yeah. But my point is, though, if you have someone in your life, whether it's a workout partner, which is awesome, or just someone who is going to hold you accountable. And when I say hold you accountable, it's like this, you know, I do this with a friend of mine. We're actually I'm going to revisit the idea, but okay, you've got a goal. You want to work out 5 days a week for the next 5 months, right? And you have a certain maybe amount of muscle or certain strength goals you want to build. And if you don't achieve those, there's a consequence at the end. Mm-hmm. And the consequence is not, he's going to beat me up. A consequence is like, okay, if you don't do this and you don't say what you're going to do, I'm going to hold you accountable as your friend that you're going to wash my car. You're going to clean my house. You're going to make me dinner.
That's great.
If you don't, and it's got to be something where you're kind of like, it can't be like, you know, you're going to take me out for ice cream. No, it's got to be something that like, you're going to bust your ass to make this goal happen because you don't want that consequence. And listen, we're human beings. We're motivated by a carrot and a stick. This is everyone. You get the reward, you get the stick. So for me, it's helpful to have someone in my life to have that encouragement and hold me accountable because I know I'm going to work harder.
And now there are websites that it's called like Healthy Bet and stuff like sites like that where you have to put money down.
There
and
you go.
In order to, I don't know entirely how they work, but it's all financial related. And if you achieve your goal, you can get X amount of money and all that sort of stuff. So
that would motivate me.
If you don't achieve your goal, maybe you should start doing that. Try it out. All right, let's move on. We're going to do one or two more questions. Let's see what we got here. So Lisa was okay. So follow up to Lisa's question in the beginning. I don't do conventional caffeine anymore because it doesn't help keep me awake and it's not good for sleep hygiene. Mm-hmm. So she's going to try out the products we recommended. Great. And Kate asked, let's make this our last question. And then I have something I meant to tell you guys about earlier. So Kate said, I'm going to San Francisco next year and I saw a few videos on cool vegan grocery stores and restaurants. But I was curious about cool environmentally friendly shopping places like clothing shopping and cool knickknacks.
Great question.
There are definitely some good places there. I used to live in San Francisco. And number one would be that fair trade store in Noe Valley. Is it called? Equal Exchange, I think. That place is awesome. I always try to go there. Number one. Number two would be Rainbow Grocery. Not just a grocery store, but they sell lots of really great products there. There are a lot of really good thrift stores. I've always loved thrift shopping.
Painted Bird is my favorite.
Painted Bird, yeah, that's a really cool place. The Mission District on like Valencia has that, just that street alone is great. So that whole area, you can start in Noe Valley at Equal Exchange, and that street is really cool. I don't remember if there are any other eco shops there. But who knows if it's changed. I haven't been for a year, but that street, forget what that street is, but look up Equal Exchange.
Or is it Global Exchange?
Maybe it's Global Exchange.
Sorry.
Yeah, I think it's Global Exchange. It's a fair trade store in San Francisco in Noe Valley. Mm-hmm. You can go there and you can literally park your car there, walk down the street, walk up Valencia Street in the Mission, and they're all great shops. Like there are restaurants, there's, you know, little grocery stores, and I love Valencia. And then you can make your way to Rainbow Grocery from there. And that would be a really long walk, couple hours, but it'd be great. Or you can get a bike. You could take a bus around. The BART system wouldn't be that helpful in those places. But I think it'd be great to spend the day downtown San Francisco. But I can't think of anything store-wise anywhere else in the city. I'm sure that the Bay Area has some. And if anyone else is watching from the Bay Area, and I'm sorry, the East Bay, I meant to say. The East Bay probably has a few places. I would check out Veg News. They often will have a lot of resources because they're based in the Bay Area. And if anyone else wants to chime in, go for it. But I think staying in the Mission District in Noe Valley is a good place to focus your time for eco-friendly and vegan things. All right, well, let's start wrapping things up. And if anyone else wants to sneak in a question, go ahead. I should have mentioned these during the Thanksgiving part. I like to recommend at least one cool product each video. And of course, I've talked about books and food today, but I've been meaning to tell you guys about these really cool things. Speaking of eco-vegan, so last year for Christmas, I bought one of these for my parents and I thought they were so cool. And then this company reached out to me asking if I wanted to try out their winter themed. They actually even have a Halloween theme one that's really cool. But these are from a company called Charles, I think it's pronounced. Vianson. Thank you. Right here. And they make these cool lids that are made from silicone that are an alternative to using saran wrap or even foil and all of that. And you can put these on any smooth surface. One of us is ringing. That's you, I think. You can put this on any smooth surface, whether it's a stainless steel, glass, plastic, or ceramic, and it seals it as a cover. So you can see right here, this is so great. We're definitely going to use these for Thanksgiving, because when you're bringing food around to different homes, this isn't the most Thanksgiving-y. This is more for Christmas. And then they have one that is for Halloween, although this could pass for Thanksgiving.
It's a pumpkin. Yeah, absolutely it could.
Right? Squash is still Thanksgiving-y, and probably even the for Christmas too, fall and winter. And it's just so neat. So look right here. So instead of putting Saran Wrap on top of a bowl of salad, you can use this thing. It suctions on so well that you can practically lift the item up. And they've got them in all these different sizes. And they even have one for drinks. So if you're, a wine stopper.
A wine stopper, nice.
Isn't that cool? I love these. And like I said, I got one from my dad last year. They also have the flower shapes and designs. And they're so pretty. Imagine how cool we'll look when we walk into Thanksgiving with our dishes covered with this, instead of just Saran Wrap that you're going to throw out. It's such a waste. Or, in the past, instead of Saran Wrap, last year, I think when I went to my Thanksgiving potluck, I wrapped it in a towel, a kitchen towel. But it looks so ghetto. I mean, it looks really lame. On the other hand, I'm going to be walking in there with my dish, and it's looking all cool in there, and everyone's going to be like, what is that? And even, to that question earlier about Thanksgiving, you walk in with some really good yams with vegan marshmallows and this covering up the top, everybody's going to want to try it.
Ambrosia salad.
Yeah.
It's on.
So I'm excited. I'll definitely take some pictures. I had to tell you guys about these because I think they're cool. And I found them when I bought it from my dad. I bought it at Sur La Table. And so you can definitely check that place. I know they sell it. But if you just go to Charles Vianson's website, I'll link to that down below. And they're probably on Amazon as well. You can also tell that I chipped my nail earlier today. Don't you hate it when that happens?
I do. It happens all the time.
Let's see. So we're going to wrap things up today. Thank you, everyone, for watching. I just want to, usually I have announcements at the beginning, but I'm now going to put them at the end. Reminder of the t-shirts for the holidays. If you're looking for holiday gifts, the Food is My Healthcare t-shirts are in stock in all sizes. Well, not in stock in all sizes, but I'm guaranteeing that whatever you order before December 15th or 10th-ish will be to you by Christmas. If you're getting it for a Christmas gift or any other holiday gift, you can order that at ecovegangal.com or store. I think it's store.ecovegangal.com. I'll link to it down below. As well as my ebook, Healthy Organic Vegan on a Budget, is on sale right now. And I'm really so excited to have that out finally. And that is ecovegangal.com/healthyorganicveganonabudget. The link is right down below. What are you doing in terms of, you've got you're working on your book. Mm-hmm. He has a free ebook out right now. Mm-hmm. And he's actually going to have his t-shirts out. Have you started your sales page for that yet?
The t-shirts are not here yet. They're going to be in my possession probably in the next week or two in time for Christmas.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you guys want to go to store.jasonrobel, JASONWROBEL.com, or using the same t-shirt selling service.
No. Mine's separate. We're both using Store Envy, but I set up a special URL for mine.
Ah. So. Well, anyway, you can go there. You can pre-order the shirts. They're going to be here in the next 2 weeks. They're going to be fun and organic and awesome. And so the book is being worked on. Working on a new ebook for next year. All kinds of good things.
Yeah.
Media. Growing a beard. That's been going well, clearly. A lot of compliments on the beard.
It's awesome. And we both have social media, of course, and the newsletter list and all of that. And all that is accessible at ecovegangal.com and jasonrobel.com. I have two things that I'm working on right now. One, I think I'm going to launch next week. And the other, I'm going to announce soon and then launch in January. So stay tuned, sign up for the newsletter list and pay attention on social media, because I'm really excited about these two projects. And they were designed specifically for you. So I think you're going to be equally excited. We would love to stay in touch with you. Please let us know in the comments section below on YouTube. anything that you'd like to talk about. Do you have other products or websites or books or whatever else you want to recommend? Do you have any other further information you want to share? Let us know there. In terms of questions, if you look in the YouTube description field, there is a link to ask your questions for the future to make sure that it's asked at some point in one of these Q&As, and that is the bit.ly link / I think it's just weekly QA. If you click on that, you can submit your question. And the whole point of these Q&As is to answer your questions. I do them every Saturday, so I look forward to seeing you next time. Either it might just be me, or I'll be bringing on Robert Cheek soon. Kathy Patalsky's coming on soon. And I also have a list of other guests that I'm going to be asking throughout the course of 2015. So if you have a request for a certain guest, let me know, and I will definitely reach out to them and try to get them on the show so that we can hear a variety of different perspectives on healthy vegan living. Thank you so much, Jason, for being here.
Pleasure.
And to all of you for watching. I hope you learned something, you feel inspired and supported. We are here for you, and we're just really grateful that you tuned in today. I will see you next time. Have a good one, everyone.
And
happy Thanksgiving. I want to hear. Seriously, tell me what you're going to make and send the recipe.
We want pictures.
Yes.
We want pictures.
Or just a link, or just a description, whatever you want to put. I love hearing about it. I'm getting really excited for Thanksgiving.
I know, I'm hungry.
Especially with one of these. I'm so excited. You know it's going to look cool. Right? They didn't pay me to say that, by the way. I'm just really, really excited. Okay, bye, guys.